The second speaker is Professor Thor Willie Hansen. Professor Hansen was introduced this morning twice, but I will just remind you that he is Emeritus Professor in Oslo, Norway, and he is one of the what we call them bilirubinologists. They are experts in bilirubin that they meet every year at the pass. And he's going to San Francisco next week, I guess, for the meeting. They discuss the bilirubin issue together with Professor Potania and the other groups. But he's not going to talk about bilirubin this afternoon. His talk is about medication error in neonatology. Please, Professor.
So good afternoon, everybody, and I'm impressed that you are still awake and still with us. And my fellow Scandinavian colleague has done a good job of keeping you awake and alert. I shall do my best to continue that good trend. So drug treatment of children. Well, I have a sort of hobby interest in medical history. And I can tell you that the history of medical treatment of children goes back thousands of years. Many treatments were applied to the skin, for instance, in the form of cupping, or blistering, or scarification, or moxibustion. Some stuff was given by mouth. For instance, I don't know if you think that wine was a good idea for preemies, but they put them in both by mouth and by enema. There's an Egyptian papyrus known as Eber's papyrus from 3,600 years ago that provides the following recipe for treating colics. Capsules from the opium plant, fly feces from the wall, mix and strain and take it for 4 days. It works right away. And I don't know if you find it attractive and how it worked. I have no clue. Microscopic examination of Egyptian child mummies showed that they were often afflicted with roundworm, flatworm, schistosoma, filaria, and ankylostoma. And a decoction of bark and roots from the pomegranate tree was used as treatment against worms. And once again, if it worked, I don't know. So let's jump forward to our times. This grave plaque. Underneath that is found the remains of Patrick Bouvier Kennedy, who lived a short life of 2 days in 1963. His parents were rather famous, President John Fitzgerald and his wife Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy. He was delivered at a hospital in Boston with a cesarean section after 34 weeks gestation and weighed 2.1 kilos, and he died 2 days old. Purportedly due to hyaline membrane disease, and he's buried then next to his father on Arlington Memorial or National Cemetery in Washington, D.C. Now, this is 54 years ago, or 53 plus. Today, it's highly unlikely in our parts of the world that a baby at 34 weeks gestation would die from respiratory syndrome. So if we assume that's what Patrick had, that would be exceptional, and somebody would probably call a lawyer. Now, this is, I admit, this picture is a little bit dated. It's a few years old, but it's somewhat representative. This is our modern neonatal patient. So we have a list of 10 different things going on: nitric oxide, respirator, monitor, overhead heat, a pump with PGE, another pump with dopamine, a third pump with fluid and nutrition, a fourth pump with pain meds and sedation, and then we have a pressure pump. And somewhere hidden in all this stuff behind the number 10 is our patient. In other words, it's complicated stuff. So what's the story of children and drugs? Well, the first take-home message is children are not small adults. And newborn infants are even less so small adults. History has taught us that many things can go wrong if drugs for adults are given to children without knowing how their bodies process and tolerate drugs. But in spite of this, as many of you, perhaps most of you know, many of the drugs that we use in our NICUs on a daily basis were introduced according to the so-called compassionate care principle. In other words, we have no clue what we're doing, but it helped a bigger kid than an adult, so maybe it will help this baby. So what is a reasonable definition of medication error? Well, there is an American National Coordinating Council for Medication Error Reporting and Prevention, and their definition, I thought, was pretty good. They define this as any preventable event that may cause or lead to inappropriate medication use or patient harm while the medication is in the control of the healthcare professional, patient, or consumer. Such events may be related to professional practice, healthcare products, procedures, and systems, including prescribing, order communication, product labeling, packaging, nomenclature, compounding, dispensing, distribution, administration, education, monitoring, and use. In other words, there are many steps in this staircase on which we may trip. Now, an adverse drug event, on the other hand, is an injury that results from medication use, and that may or may not include expected adverse drug reactions or side effects. Our newborn babies are a vulnerable population. Here is a long list, which is probably not exhausted. When they're sick, they're really sick. The treatment, as I've just shown in the previous slide, is sometimes intricate and complex. Their physiology is immature. We have the challenges involved in multidisciplinary care, in which it's sometimes very complex to communicate. Our technology is challenging. I don't know how many of you have intubated a 300-plus gram baby, but I have, and I can tell you, even a 2.5-sized endotracheal tube looks like an elephant's snout. They have a rapidly changing body size. This particular baby that weighed 300 grams plus, by the time he was discharged from the nursery, he weighed 20 times as much as he did at birth. We have a number of drugs that we use, so-called off-label. 80%, in fact, of the drugs in the NICU are not designed for or tested for use in newborns. Sometimes we don't communicate properly. Then we have the changing developmental systems in the babies that can affect drug absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. And finally, what makes this extremely vexing is that many years may pass before we know the actual end result in that particular baby. So what are the common errors in neonatal pharmacotherapy? Well, once again, there is a long list. Incorrect or imprecise drug ordination, the wrong drug, wrong dose. Factor errors are certainly a bane in neonatology. Wrong patient weight, rate error, error in timing, should have been given 6 a.m., ended up being given 6 p.m. Oh, I forgot, should have gotten it at noon, ended up giving it at 3 p.m. Oh, I forgot the whole dose kind of thing. Wrong route, I don't know how many of you, but I have certainly had a very disturbed nurse coming to me running, oh, I just gave the PO mixture intravenously. Wrong technique. Should have been given as a 5-minute push, was given as a 5-hour infusion. Wrong or name confusion. I've just used my name as an example. Hansen with one or two S's or Hansen with an S-O. Mix-up of twins or triplets. Should have been given to trip 2, was given to triplet 3. Should have been given to bed 9, was given to bed 10. Pump errors. There's a plethora of errors that our pumps may trip us up. An incompatibility of the drugs in the syringe, in the infusion tubing, in the Y connector, which could be due to pH or chemistry or solvents or calcium or magnesium or whatever. Here is a list that Chapel and Newman suggested a few years ago about categories of medication errors. I'm not going to go into everything in detail, but they range from no error, no harm, in other words, it was caught before it happened, to a fatal error in which the patient died. Our knowledge about drug metabolism in newborn infants still needs developing. There is many white spots on our maps.
And I'm just giving you there two examples of knowledge that have come up in recent years. For instance, inhibition of stimulation of hepatic cytochrome oxidases and phosphoglycoprotein transporters in the blood-brain barrier. And what are, for instance, the implications of the cytochrome oxidase system? Well, we know that a lot of drug metabolism goes through that system. And these SIPs have variable maturation, which will lead to variable metabolism. Many of them are inhibited by such fairly common things in the NICU as septicemia or multi-organ failure. And the number of inductors or inhibitors can influence drug metabolism. And we can give one drug that inhibits the SIP that the next drug needs in order to be metabolized. Other things that we are often in the clouds about is what are the implications of immaturity, growth, maturation? What's the difference between a 24-weeker and a 34-weeker? And not the least problem is how does drug metabolism mature in those who are born prematurely? Take a baby at 40 weeks gestation. One of them was just born fresh out of the womb. One was born at 24 weeks and is now 16 weeks post-birth. Can we assume that drug metabolism in these two babies is comparable? And what happens during pregnancy? The mom's sick. She has some pre-existing disorder for which she is medicated. The child is sick. Does septicemia up or down regulate metabolism? Another challenge we have in neonatal pharmacotherapy is drug compatibility. A critically ill neonate, certainly in my NICU, may at times receive somewhere along the lines of 10 to 20 different drugs at the same time. And most of these we end up giving intravenously. In addition, the child is likely to need TPM. Now, as you all know, there is no way that we can insert and maintain 10 to 20 different IV access lines in a baby. We're lucky if we get to 2 or 3. This means that several drugs must be given concurrently and through the same tubing. So we need to ask ourselves, are they compatible? Are they, for instance, compatible pH-wise? Are they soluble? Will they be precipitated by the presence of calcium? And if they do precipitate, will the precipitate block our one French IV central venous line? If they do, where the heck are we going to find the next vein for that baby? The other question that we do not nearly think enough about is, are these drugs still active when they come out at the patient end of our IV line? Now, how common are medication errors? Well, there are lots of ways to estimate or guesstimate this. Stavroudis, in a review paper almost 10 years ago, said that they're common, they're substantial, and they're preventable. But how do you count? And how reliable are your counts? You can chart review, and you can do that either concurrently or retrospectively. The problem is that what you find in chart reviews is the ordination errors, the ones that are written down, but you're not going to find the ones that have to do with dispensing or administration. But also looked at that a few years ago and found that per 100 NICU admissions, there were 91 errors. And the thing with our sick babies is that these errors are more likely to cause harm than in bigger children or even adults. Another way to look at this is occurrence reports. So Suresh et al., about a decade ago from the Vermont-Oxford Network, found that 47% of all reported medical errors in their pediatric unit occurred in neonates, and almost all of them occurred in the NICU. Most occurred during administration or dispensing, but there was also errors in ordering, transcribing, and monitoring. Harm to the patient was reported in more than one in four. Fortunately, only 2% approximately were serious and 0.2% were fatal. You can also assess the frequency of these errors through so-called trigger reports. Those are occurrences or prompts or flags found on review and that trigger further investigation. They do not detect nearly all errors, but they could be a good screening tool. Now, you can also do in our modern computerized times, if these things go through computer networks, you can do computerized searches. And Feinstein et al. In 2015 had searched almost 500,000 hospitalizations from 43 American children's hospitals. And they classified by their software potential drug-drug interaction into five levels: contraindicated, major, moderate, minor, and unknown. Of the 500,000 hospitalizations, half of them were associated with at least one potential drug-drug interaction. Contraindicated in 5% of all hospitalizations, major in 41%, etc. You can see the list. I'm not going to read through all of it. So what strategies can we use to improve? Well, I think there are at least two well-tried approaches. The one is systems analysis or tweaking, and the other one is called naming and blaming. Now, the naming and blaming game has very long historical precedent. In my part of the world, and I cannot speak for your country here, but in my country, it doesn't work well anymore because we have found in our setting that punitive reactions prevent reporting. And therefore, if you have a system that prevents reporting, you won't be able to learn from the mishap. Wrong dose. Types of error. Wrong dose, about 30% of adverse drug events. One of the causes is the rapidly changing body weight, which predisposes newborns. In one study, more than one-third of all pediatric dosing errors occurred in young babies, and half of them occurred in the NICU. Most of the errors were overdosing, but about a quarter were underdosed. Now, how can we reduce the risk of a wrong dose? In our NICU, for instance, we have made rules on prescribing. It's pretty much almost outlawed in our NICU to use decimal points, except if you must, you can have at the most one digit after the comma. So you're permitted to write 0.1 milligram, but you're not allowed 0.12, and you're certainly not allowed to write 0.1. Our preference, however, is to write this dose as 100 micrograms or 120 if it were. It's also not allowed to abbreviate milligrams as mg, micrograms as mu-g, and nanograms as ng. You must write out the full word, milligram, microgram, etc. Infusions. In our NICU, all drugs commonly administered as continuous infusions are given as standardized concentrations, and I think Dr. Ali mentioned this earlier today, and only in permitted vehicles. So we have one neonatal standard, one bigger children's standard, and for a few drugs, we have a preemie standard. And we found a compromise on the concentration that was compatible with total fluid needs for an infant of the size in question. So for each drug, then, there is a recipe for preparing it that the nurse must follow. And for each formulation, there is a sticky label to affix to the syringe, and you must write all pertinent information on the label. On each label, there is also a warning as to what you should expect in an infusion rate as far as unit per kilo per hour or milliliters per hour. And I'm sorry I don't have an example of the label in English, but I've shown you one in Norwegian on the upper right there. As you say, the text, as I said, NB, tells you that the common infusion rate for fentanyl is from 1 microgram per kilo per hour to 5 micrograms per kilo per hour, and the corresponding infusion rate in milliliters per hour is written there. All our infusion pumps are pre-programmed for each drug and each standard. So the nurse calls up the program, inputs the current weight, and must then verify that the infusion rate she ends up with is within the range suggested on the sticky label. And if she or he is in any doubt, they must call the prescribing or attending physician. We also have a system, which I'm sure many of you do, with double and triple checks. So in our NICU, at least 2 RNs must independently check and verify the dose against patient weight. If they are in any doubt, they must call the prescribing doctor or the doctor on call. Incompatibility and drug-drug interactions are a big problem. Many years ago, we made a poster of which you will see a tiny portion as an illustration on the right, to tell the nurses whether drug A and drug B were compatible. Nowadays, you have much better computer tools, and in fact, you have some very neat cell phone apps. And Truven Micromedics has one example of a company that has both an online and an app tool, and they're warmly recommended. Patient identification, armbands, name tags, commonly used, they certainly are vulnerable to human error, and arm tags, as you all know, tend to fall off. Automated techniques are being tested. You can have armbands or tags with barcodes, and you can certainly have radio frequency labeled cord clamps, which is being used in some LDRs. As far as incorrect route timing, duration, and techniques, there are several methods that have been tested or are being tested, such as barcodes, automated alerts, those radio frequency ID things, and safety pumps. But to all of you, we need new ideas. We need further research. Finally, I'd like to say a few words about safety culture. A strong institutional safety culture has been shown to reduce accident and errors. And we heard about this earlier today. The airline industry certainly has a very good track record. And I sometimes tell my staff that if the airline industry were as haphazard with their precision and safety as we seem to be sometimes, that it would be an airplane falling down every day. Norwegian petroleum companies who work in the North Sea, where the meteorological conditions are sometimes extremely adverse, they have worked very hard on their institutional safety culture, which has translated into building a North Sea floating oil drilling platform, which routinely used to cost several of the workers their lives before it was completed, now pretty much can be completed without serious incident. In fact, in one of those companies in their main office, their safety culture is so pervasive that if you are caught in their building walking down a staircase with a cup of coffee without holding the banister, you're penalized. That's how seriously they take their safety culture. And we, I think, in the healthcare sector need to learn from them. So in summary, medication errors are common. Most errors can be prevented. The human factor is important, but go for systems change and not naming and blaming. When errors do happen, it's a grievous mistake not to utilize these errors as a learning potential. Finally, new bright ideas are wanted, and I think we can all agree that we can do better. Thank you.